Casey Stoner commemorative lap around Phillip Island, a Phillip Island circuit which he pretty much owned and made his own when he was a Grand Prix rider back in the day. Stoner won here in 2007, 2008, 2009 and 2010 on the factory Ducati. He was the race winner here for Repsolon in 2011 and 2012, six consecutive races. And Casey Stoner listened to the reception he's getting from the Australian fans. He treated them to some spectacular shows, didn't he, here back in the day. 11 years ago today, Stoner won his second MotoGP World Championship back in 2011 on his 26th birthday. So of course we have to say a very happy 37th birthday today to the two times MotoGP World Champion. He now comes out of the Southern Loop towards a corner aptly named after the absolute legend. What a rider this young man was, Casey Stoner. And he comes now towards turn number three, where it was such a spectacular sight, wasn't it, to see him on both the Ducati and the Honda in MotoGP, power sliding, smoke pouring off that rear tyre through the Stoner corner. Every single man, woman and child in this Phillip Island Grand Prix crowd are on their feet, as you knew they would do, to show their appreciation, their affection and their love for one of the best motorcycle racers, not just that Australia produced in history, but one of the very best that we've ever seen since this great world championship started way, way back in 1949.
Of course, for Casey Stoner, he's coming through the corner that he made his own. One of the iconic sights of Grand Prix motorcycle racing over the years is seeing Casey Stoner sliding through what was turn three and what is now Stoner corner. You kind of get the feeling if he climbed off that truck now and walked into the factory Ducati box and jumped on one of the GP22s, you still wouldn't back against him winning around here, would you? He was so good around here in his pomp. Those six consecutive wins, the first of which of course came when he arrived here for his memorable homecoming as a MotoGP world champion with Ducati back in 2007. Of course, the last time that Ducati won the Riders' Championship, they're still trying to break that jinx. Will this afternoon's events bring them one step closer to ending that run? But Casey Stoner, an icon of MotoGP, an icon of Australian motorsport, and quite rightly and deservedly, he's getting a commemorative lap to take in the applause and the acclaim of his adoring public.
Yeah, it was always a pleasure and privilege to watch this young man go about his business around this Phillip Island circuit. Nobody did it better around this 4.44 kilometer circuit than the man we're looking at here on this special parade lap. Great scenes. And Casey, I think it's fair to say, he was a rider that didn't particularly enjoy the limelight. He just loved turning up and racing his motorcycle, but he's certainly soaking up the atmosphere here. Of course, the Australians, they've had so many great riders throughout history, haven't they, to cheer on. When you think in the sort of later stage of the modern MotoGP era, you have Wayne Gardner, 1987 world champion, Mick Doohan, a five times 500cc world champion, Casey Stoner, you think of names from the past, Kel Carruthers, one of the absolute legends from former years here, Remy Gardner, the Moto2 world champion, let's not forget him as well. Casey looks like he's enjoying this, and why wouldn't he? Because it's a chance for the Australian fans to show their gratitude towards one of the best that's ever done it out of these shores. I love that slogan as well on the side of that pickup truck, back where we belong. Love that. Yeah, we certainly are back where we belong. We missed this Australian Grand Prix since 2019. Casey Stoner's was a heck of a journey, wasn't it? He left Australia with his parents, Colin and Bronwyn. I remember they were living in a caravan, I think, in the back garden of Alberto Puig, who was such a huge influence on Casey Stoner's career. He was in that Movie Star Junior Cup. But we'll take a very quick pause because our coverage of the MotoGP race coming up here in Australia very soon. Five riders split by 40 points means the 2022 MotoGP title battle is perfectly poised coming at the Animoca Brands Grand Prix of Australia. Phillip Island is our high-speed playground for round 18. There's no hiding place at this late stage. It's time to race in MotoGP. So the magnificent Phillip Island circuit, one of the best on the entire World Championship calendar. 4.44 kilometres, 2.76 miles, 12 corners, 5 right, 7 of them left, including the Stoner corner, the Doohan corner. Hair-raising corners, those, aren't they? Turns 1 and turn 3. The best race lap, the 1:28.108, set by Marc Márquez 9 years ago, back in 2019. Of course, Jorge Lorenzo's 9-year-old pole record went yesterday to Jorge Martin. This was the classic race in 2019 at turn 10. Coming up next, then, in MotoGP. It's a magnificent seventh MotoGP pole for Jorge Martin as he looks to be the seventh different winner in 2022. Is a fifth win in Phillip Island on the cards for Marc Márquez, with the Spaniard starting second. Pecco Bagnaia hopes to use some Casey Stoner inspiration to take Ducati's first Australian Grand Prix win since 2010. And his motorcycle racing's biggest prize slipping away from Fabio Quartararo, with the world champion starting fifth. There's no better sight on the MotoGP World Championship, is there, than the Basque Coast, the waves lapping up on the beaches here of the glorious, the magnificent Phillip Island. We are back in Australia for the first time in 3 years, and we are, what, just over half an hour away from what should be a great spectacle. The Animoca Brands Grand Prix of Australia up next, round 18 of this year's MotoGP World Championship. A title chase that is very much coming to the boil in these cold conditions here in Phillip Island. Five riders split by just 40 points with three races to go. We move quickly from Phillip Island back north to Southeast Asia for the Malaysian Grand Prix in Sepang next week. And it's all pointing towards a nail-biting final round showdown in Valencia in early November. The Red Bull Aerobatic team, they're out in force, putting on a great show for the fans. But who's going to be flying to a vital MotoGP victory here in Phillip Island? Fabio Quartararo, the reigning world champion. He leads the way, 2 points clear of Pecco Bagnaia in the title chase. These were scenes earlier on today. The Australian fans have loved the atmosphere, haven't they? Poor man Jorge Martin entering the paddock as he goes for his first win of 2022. Aleix Espargaró, one of our five title contenders. We've even had people dressed up as the Pope this weekend, haven't we? Maybe some divine inspiration for Pecco Bagnaia as Ducati go in search of their first MotoGP win here in 12 long years. Their last success, Casey Stoner, his fourth of six victories. That is the prize that they are all chasing. That's the beautiful, the absolutely stunning race-winning trophy here for the winner of the Animoca Brands Grand Prix of Australia. These are live pictures then, as the tension builds in our build-up to this 18th round of the World Championship. Live coverage brought to you by Matt Burt, Lewis Sutherby in the commentary box, Simon Crafar down in pit lane. So many race-winning contenders in this Grand Prix. We've got a front row led by Jorge Martin, Marc Márquez and Pecco Bagnaia also inside that top three. But there are at least, Lewis, half a dozen names that have stuck their head above the parapet this weekend and threatened race-winning pace.
Including Pecco Bagnaia here on screen, who is eyeing the World Championship lead here this afternoon. He would have never dreamt that 91 points behind after the German Grand Prix that he could still clinch this World Championship, and he could leave Phillip Island later on today as the leader of the World Championship for the first time in his career. 2 points behind Fabio Quartararo, but as Matt said, there's no shortage of race-winning contenders here this afternoon. The general consensus up and down the pit lane is that there could be as many as 10 or 12 riders who've got the pace to run at the front for the first half of the Grand Prix, but only maybe four or five who can stay there for the full race. Marc Márquez certainly feels as if he could be amongst them. Second on the grid for one of the masters, the modern-day masters of Phillip Island. He has never started off the front row of the grid here, and he kept that record intact yesterday.
Fair to say, he's got a checkered MotoGP history, though, hasn't he, Marc Márquez? The 29-year-old Spaniard. His last six races here have been a sequence of DNF win, DNF win, DNF win. I hope for his sake that sequence doesn't roll on here today. Now then, looking relatively relaxed, relatively calm as he fist bumps his entire backroom team here inside that Monster Energy Yamaha garage is Fabio Quartararo. The lady luck has really deserted him of late, hasn't it? Taken out on the first lap when he had podium pace in Aragon, the inadvertent collision with Marc Márquez, and then a disaster, a horrible wet Grand Prix in Buriram a couple of weeks ago. No points in two of the last three Grand Prix for Quartararo. That's seen his world championship lead shrink to that narrow margin of 2 points. And what lies in store for Australian, the homecoming hero, Jack Miller, number five of our five world title contenders, 40 points he is adrift in the championship chase, but he's had a great flyaway tour so far here, hasn't he? The race winner in Japan, second, a close second to Miguel Oliveira in those rain conditions in Buriram 2 weeks ago. And he starts, if you believe in omens, from the third row where he's had those two podiums in those last two Grand Prix. I've got to say, Lewis, at least outwardly, our main title men are sort of oozing calm, oozing cool, but there's got to be a few nerves jangling inside those stomachs right now.
Certainly, given how much is on the line. There's one man who knows all about title deciders. I think we'll leave it at that. Michael Massey, former Formula One race director, sharing a conversation there with Massimo Ravola and Paolo Cambinotti at Pramac Racing. But we have got three races to go in the race for the MotoGP world title of 2022. And we're at the stage where one mistake, one crucial slip, or one loss of the front, one potential high side could be the difference between winning the world championship and losing it. 20 points covering the top three. We saw Aleix Espargaró a few months ago. You kind of feel for him. He's got to go for wins here now. He starts from the front of the second row. He kind of felt that a mistake through the last corner yesterday cost him pole position when he was being towed around by his teammate Maverick Vinales. He thanked his teammate after qualifying for the assistance from Maverick Vinales, but he got too close to him in qualifying and it cost him a row on the grid.
Well, MotoGP is our religion, isn't it? We love this spot. I've seen that fan knocking around the paddock all weekend. What a great character. I don't think there's any question where his allegiance is lying here this weekend. He'll be praying and hoping that there's more race-winning success coming here for Ducati this weekend. As we mentioned, it's 2010 since they took their last success. Many people think if that run's going to end today, it'll be in the hands of Pecco Bagnaia, but do not discount this man, Joan Zarco, on the Prima Pramac racing machine. He was the top dog here in Phillip Island on Friday, quickest in FP1 and in FP2. And surely, sooner rather than later, his long run without a MotoGP success has to come to an end. This is Premier Class start number 102 for Joan Zarco.
Well, the last time we raced here around Phillip Island, Maverick Vinales was a lap away from victory in that head-to-head showdown with Marc Márquez in the 2019 Australian Grand Prix. Was overtaken for the lead and then decked it on the way down into the MG corner on the final lap. So unfinished business in some respects for Maverick Vinales here this afternoon. He showed in free practice for yesterday that he has potential race-winning pace, but he's going to need a good start to this Grand Prix from 12th on the grid. A grid led by Jorge Martin here on screen, who ended his wait for a pole position stretching back to the fourth round of the season in the Grand Prix of the Americas. Martin is certainly one of the riders that Marc Márquez earmarked as a race-winning contender. Can he convert pole position into victory? He, like Marc Márquez, has nothing to lose today.
I tell you what, I'm loving that special improvised Marc Márquez headgear there from 293 Law supporters. The gloves go on, and very soon it'll be gloves off time, won't it, in the literal sense for Marc Márquez as he starts from second place on the grid. You just know that he's going to go all in, go for broke, isn't he? He's threatened. He looks like he is getting back to the old magic Márquez. We saw that perfect evidence, perfect demonstration in halfway through that Q2 session yesterday when he had that super save, another Márquez miracle save on his knee and his elbow into turn 10. So here we go then. The build-up to this Australian Grand Prix continues. First man out of pit lane will be the world champion, Fabio Quartararo. I'll be hoping to be the first man to take the checkered flag in just about 70 minutes' time then, as he looks to increase that very narrow two-point World Championship lead. Fabio Quartararo told the media yesterday, now is not the time to think about defending. He's got nothing to defend. It's all about attacking now when your lead is just 2 points. What can he do about the likes of Pekka Bagnaia and Aleix Espargaró around him? That brings an added dimension to this Grand Prix for me, because Bagnaia on the front row in third, directly behind him on the grid on that second row are his two other rivals, Aleix Espargaró and Fabio Quartararo, with Johann Zarco completing that second row.
Well, tyre choice was always going to be a key factor going into this Grand Prix here today. And one of the key features, one of the key details going into this Grand Prix was the temperature. Speaking to Piero Taramasso yesterday, we heard him interviewed by Simon Crefar in the lead up to free practice three. And they told us that 35 degrees was the key cutoff point. That was the temperature that they would be looking for to decide who would be able to go for the harder rear tyre. It appears it's going to be a straight choice between the medium and the harder rear tyre. Here are the options being brought by Michelin, all asymmetric, the tyre options, given the punishment that the left-hand side of the tyre receives around this anti-clockwise circuit. The left-hand side of the tyre, as you can see there, is the harder of the compounds. The softer compound is on the right-hand side. And we will soon have full information from Michelin as to who has gone to the grid on what going into this 27-lap Australian Grand Prix. Fabio Quartararo coming around to the grid. He's certainly got support behind him. Quartararo just 2 points ahead in the World Championship, but he's not in a position now, as Matt mentioned, that he can protect his lead. He's got to attack now and go for it. So what will he do from the second row of the grid? It only cost him 200ths of a second. That was all it took for Fabio Quartararo to be on the front row of the grid, the front row that is occupied by Pecco Bagnaia. But the tension is, of course, super high. The stakes are super high. One mistake, as mentioned, at this stage of the game could really make the difference in the race for the World Championship. As Bagnaia is pushed into position. A lot of the support, of course, here is for his teammate, Jack Miller. The 43s fly proudly. The Australian fans certainly get support and get behind their own. Today will be no difference. The newly married Jack Miller pulls into position in the third row of the grid. And he will, of course, be racing around a corner named after himself. Yesterday, we saw Turn 4 renamed as the Miller Corner.
Jorge Martin then rolls up to pole position for the first time since round four at the Circuit of the Americas in Austin, Texas. Publicly, at least, he's spoken of not really being too bothered about the sort of thorny issue of team orders. He said in Burham, if he was in Johann Zarco's position, he would have gone full attack and battled for the podium. And that's his ploy, that's his plot here today, as Ducati look for what would be their 12th win of this incredible season already so far this year. A 12th win for them and for Pekka Bagnaia today. It doesn't matter what happens to Fabio Quartararo, it would mean Bagnaia would go to Malaysia next weekend as the MotoGP World Championship leader. But you just know that this man is going to have a significant role to play in the action coming up in just over 20 minutes' time here. The Animoca Brands Grand Prix of Australia, we've run over 27 laps, and there's so much hope, so much expectation and pressure on the shoulders of one man. I'm delighted to say, ahead of his home Grand Prix, Jack Miller is down on the grid with Simon Crafer.
He is, and I can see Jack calculating a few things, talking to his crew. Jack, you can always feel the tension on the grid down here, but home GP, how are you feeling?
If I didn't say I was nervous, I'd be lying. It's awesome to be back, you know. Massive turnout this year. It's amazing to see all the grandstands full and, you know, all the Aussies coming out to support. The weather's turning on for us. It's not too windy. It's nice and warm. So, well, semi-warm. You're still rugged up. But, it's awesome. Great to be back. Hopefully we can put on a decent show.
Best of luck, Jack. We'll be cheering.
Thanks, Simon.
Jack Miller going for three podiums in a row for the first time in his MotoGP career. He did win a 2014 Moto3 thriller here 8 years ago.
Here's the grid then. It's Martin, Marquez and Bagnaia. And you can see at the moment on screen the provisional tyre options. Marc Marquez has gone to the grid on a soft rear tyre. That's a brave call from Marc Marquez. Second row is Aleix Espargaró, Fabio Quartararo and Joan Zarco. Marini, Miller and Bezzecchi together on row three. They've all gone for the harder rear option. Alex Rins on the medium. He starts at the head of row four, ahead of Alex Marquez and Maverick Vinales, with Pol Espargaró, Joan Mir and Andrea Bastianini together on row five. Brad Binder, Cal Crutchlow and Darren Binder together on row six. Then comes Remy Gardner, Fabio Di Giannantonio and Raul Fernandez. And then Franco Morbidelli, Tatsuta Nakashima and Miguel Oliveira complete the grid. Miguel Oliveira had qualified 21st. He was relegated three places to 24th due to an indiscretion in qualifying when he got in the way of Andrea Bastianini. He also stopped out on track, having not taken the checkered flag yet, which also led to an additional penalty. In addition to starting last, Oliveira will have to serve a long lap penalty today.
Great scenes down the grid there as Jack Miller gets some late words of encouragement from a legend in this part of the world. 1987 500cc world champion Wayne Gardner, of course, has got his son Remy on this 27 lap grid. There's nine previous victories for Australians at Phillip Island. Wayne Gardner in 1989 and 1990, Mick Doohan in 98, and then Casey Stoner's unstoppable run from 2007 to 2012.
Let's head down to the grid then. The pole man, Jorge Martin, has a lot of weight on his shoulders, although he doesn't have the World Championship to worry about today. So what are the chances of him converting pole position into victory? Let's get some word from Prima Parac Racing and Fonti Nieto, who's with Simon.
He is, Fonti, standing next to Jorge. We know how fast he is. He's got to be one of the fastest guys, but he's less experienced, especially at Phillip Island, on a MotoGP bike, getting that rear tyre to the end. What are your thoughts?
For sure, that's true. The wind changed from the yesterday and the direction of the wind. And we are thinking about this now in the grid with a map. He says it's difficult to make the last corner because the wind pushed out. And we are thinking about to change something for the race because this condition we find only in the lap to go out to the grid. And for sure it's one of the difficult races for the tires of the calendar, and it's very important to start in front, try to save the tires in the beginning and try to arrive to the end, especially with the front and also with the rear, because in this track when you start to lose in the grip in the last corner is so difficult with the movements.
Fonsi, thank you for time, good luck.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks, Simon. Thanks to Prima Pramac Racing's Fonzi Nieto. Then will there be some late tyre choice and some late tweaks for the pole man, Jorge Martin? Well, there's our good buddy Jack Appleyard doing his social media walk right now, and he's grabbed an absolute legend in this part of the world, hasn't he? Five times 500cc world champion, Mick Doohan.
That's live on Instagram, by the way, if you want to watch that alongside our coverage.
Let's go back down on the grid then. It's pretty windy down there. I don't know if I heard Simon correctly, but I do believe he's got Repsol on the team manager, Alberto Puge, on the grid. Simon, down to you.
Yes, I have. Alberto, I haven't felt more confident about Mark standing on the podium this year. I'm wondering, how do you feel?
Well, you never know. This is always a tough race and things happen, but he did a good practice and we are confident, but I mean, also other guys are going to be pushing, so it's going to be always racing in Phillip Island is complicated and tough, so let's see what's going on.
Can you explain a little about complicated and tough? I gather you mean tyre-wise, but what else?
The average speed is high in this track, so when you have a high average speed, you can feel that it's more thrilling or demanding than in slow track. This is my feeling.
Thank you. Good luck.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks to Alberto Puig. As it stands, the provisional tyre information, which Lewis will give you an indication of very, very shortly, but as it stands right now, Marc Marquez came to the grid, the only rider with that soft rear tyre. Lewis, some more information available now from Michelin.
Yeah, talk about going for broke. Marc Marquez is certainly doing that if he goes with the soft rear tyre. Of course, he made that decision as well back at Motegi. In terms of the rear option, which was what we expected there to be some indecision between the medium and the hard, with the exception of Marc Marquez, who's gone for the the soft. The vast majority of the field have gone to the grid on the harder rear tyre. I told you earlier on that it was 35 degrees of track temperature that Piero Taramasso said it required for the harder rear tyre to work. That is exactly what we've got at the moment. But there are five exceptions who've gone for the medium. They are Raul Fernandez and Remy Gardner on the Tech 3 KTMs, Duan Mir and Alex Rins on the Suzukis, and Cal Crutchlow on the R&F Yamaha. There is much more of a split, kind of 50-50, on the front tyre option between the medium and the hard, although we did already hear from Fonzie Nieto that Prima Parent Racing are considering a switch. Both Martin and Zarco went to the grid on the medium front tyre. Quartararo of the championship contenders, he went to the grid on the harder front tyre. Pecco Bagnaia went for the medium, and Aleix Espargaró went with the hard.
This is why we love coming to the Australian Grand Prix at Phillip Island. Breathtaking helicopter shots. Always beautiful, isn't it, when the sun is shining, and we hope we are going to get, it looks like we will get, a dry Animoca Brands Grand Prix of Australia. You can almost feel the tension building in the air, can't you, as we swoop down, overlooking the grid. 24 of the best riders in the world on 24 of the fastest motorcycles in the world getting set for this battle over 27 laps. Special moment. He said it was a dream come true, a moment he's dreamt of since he was a little boy, building his future in Australia back in the day. Remy Gardner, at the moment, this will be his one and only MotoGP World Championship appearance. We certainly hope that's not the case, as he looks to try and rebuild his career over in World Superbikes. Just a quick reminder, of course, for World Superbike fans and two-wheel motorsport fans, very, very quickly, the final round of this year's World Superbike Championship will be here, November the 20th. Now then, the clock is ticking down on the factory Suzuki team's career in the MotoGP World Championship. Can they finish with a flourish? Well, Alex Rins today goes from 10th place on the grid, with Joan Mir in 14th on his return from injury. Let's get some pre-race thoughts of their team manager, Livio Supo, with Simon.
Livio, there's a lot of obvious guys for the podium today. You know, a lot. There's a good five guys you can pick out. But the reason for me to come see you, sorry, I think we're losing some signal here, is Juan Mir's race pace was awesome. Like, in my opinion, podium. What about in yours?
Nah, you're right. He has a very good pace. Sure, he need to manage the front tire. For him, is the more difficult part will be to manage the front tire, but race pace yesterday was very good, and we are very happy, because after a few races out, it's not easy to come back in such a fast circuit and immediately, bam, being there. And but I guess also in the race, also Alex can be good. Usually both they are good in managing the tires, and this seems to be a race where it will be very important, so let's wait and see.
Thanks, Livio. Good luck.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks to Livio Supo. Thanks to Simon, as always. Very, very shortly, we'll be getting the traditional pre-race grid ceremony. Looking forward to hearing singer Emily Williams belt out what's one of the classic national anthems, Advance Australia Fair. It's an emotional time for Jack Miller. We saw those banners, didn't we? Viva Miller. It should be Viva Miller's now, shouldn't it, really? Having tied the knot 8 days ago last weekend in Townsville to his good lady Ruby. And at the newly named Turn 4, named the Miller Corner, there are the Miller fans out in force. Before we get the national anthem, we'll just pop down to the grid very, very quickly to hear from Aprilia Racing boss Paolo Bonora with Simon.
Paolo, nervous. I'm nervous for the title contenders. You must be, you know, with your man Aleix Espargaró. Tell us how you feel.
I'm nervous too. It is a key race for us. For sure, we put everything on the racetrack, 100% and more, with both riders. Unfortunately, with Maverick, the qualifying lap was not so good, and could be difficult probably for him to overtake many riders. But we trust on him, so he has a good race pace, so he could approach the race with a good mood. And for sure, Alex will push everything since the start.
Paolo, thank you, and best of luck.
Thanks so much.
Yeah, thanks to Paolo Bonora. Aleix Espargaró has kind of hinted all weekend here in Australia, It's time to win, now or never, as he sits 20 points behind world championship leader Fabio Quartararo, recovering 3, 4, 5, 6 points. Just won't cut it now if he is to pull off one of the biggest shocks in Grand Prix history, with the greatest respect to the factory Aprilia team. But even before the start of this season, they were still very much underdogs, but they are genuine serious title contenders this year. But you do feel, his words himself, time to attack, time to deliver. Aleix Espargaró needs badly that second win of the season.
Yeah, well, fast approaching the point of no return in the chase for the World Championship. 2 points between Quartararo and Bagnaia, a 20-point deficit for Aleix Espargaró. As far as Jack Miller and Enea Bastianini are concerned, the two outsiders in this five-way title fight, 39 and 40 points behind for Bastianini and Miller. Bastianini, of course, way back on the grid. He starts 15th, Jack Miller in 8th. You get the feeling, if they don't win here this afternoon, with only two more races to go at the end of this one, their title hopes will surely be over. Is Fabio Quartararo's time as the world championship leader about to come to an end? If they finish where they start, he will lose the world championship lead to Pecco Bagnaia. But if there is one race where really all bets are off and you're expecting a big group and plenty of action at the front, it's here.
We are now going to pause for a rendition of Advance Australia Fair.
Let us rejoice, for we are young and free, with golden soil and wealth for toil. Our home is girt by sea, our land abounds in nature's gifts of beauty, rich and rare. In history's page, let every state advance Australia fair. In joyful strength, and let us sing, advance Australia fair.
Oh my gosh, oh wow. What an incredible version of Advance Australia Fair. A brilliant performance by Emily Williams. I'll be buying tickets for a concert that she's going to be doing anytime shortly, because that, if that didn't make the hairs on the back of your neck stand up, then nothing will. Absolutely brilliant way to continue our build-up of this Australian Grand Prix. Then now it's a big, big weekend. They're all big race, aren't they, at this stage of the season. But today, Fabio Quartararo trying to protect or increase that 2-point world champs lead he has over Pecco Bagnaia. Let's get the pre-race thoughts of his team manager, Mayo Marigali, with Simon on the grid.
Mayo, today feels like a really key day. Please give us your thoughts going into the race.
Well, we prepare the races. We always try in the best way as possible. It was a pity that this morning the warm-up was wet, because we had some work to finish. But what he shown during this, especially yesterday's session, it was pretty fast and also confident. Much more than Friday. Here, I think, is the only circuit where we can probably exploit our good point. And also is a place where I can't say that it's easy to overtake, but at least it's feasible. So, as always, it's going to be very important to start very well and try to attack at the beginning. Also, the tire choice we decide to take, especially with the front, I think it will give him some more confidence since the beginning. And he has to try. Now is everything up to him.
Mayo, we wish you the very best of luck.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, they've done all the homework, they've done all the prep work, and when all's said and done, it now just comes down to the man twisting the throttle and grabbing the brakes. Fabio Quartararo, then, in the modern four-stroke MotoGP era, 2015 is the only year where the rider leading the world championship with three races remaining hasn't won the title. I'm going to avoid stirring up too much of a hornet's nest, because it was obviously Valentino Rossi, but it gives you an indication it's normally the man in this stage of the season that can get the job done. What is going through the mind then of this young man now, the 23-year-old Frenchman, trying to successfully defend the title he won so brilliantly last year in 2021. He feels like that experience of fighting for the title in both 2020 and 2021 makes him better equipped to deal with the pressure cooker atmosphere of this battle. Medium front hard rear tyre is fitted to Quartararo's factory Yamaha.
Interesting that, because sorry, the information we had coming to the grid from Michelin was that Quartararo had gone to the grid on the harder front tyre option, so he's made a switch on the grid.
Just wonder whether that sort of pickup of the wind and maybe the fact that the temperatures will continue to probably drop over the next 50 minutes or so, whether that was a major, major factor in Fabio Quartararo's decision. Always fireworks, aren't there, when Marc Marquez is knocking around. Seven of his eight finishes this year have been inside the top six. It's today, though, the day. It's been nearly a full calendar year since he took his 99th MotoGP podium with his last victory in the Emilia-Romagna Grand Prix Misano last October. It's today the day finally makes it to a century of MotoGP podiums, maybe even better, with an 86th career victory.
Safety car leaves the grid. 5 minutes to go until the race start. Concentration in the eyes of Aleix Espargaró. It's not must-win territory for him today, but he certainly needs to pull points back on Fabio Quartararo and Pecco Bagnaia. Just two races to go at the end of this one. Quartararo limbering up for action. Can he exploit the strengths of that Yamaha M1, as Mauro Marigali tells us they must do on the grid? Sepang and Valencia to come, but Phillip Island, it is one of the great settings in motorcycle racing, and the stakes could barely be higher with three to go in the 2022 MotoGP World Championship.
Pecco Bagnaia braced and ready for one of the biggest 27-lap races of his Grand Prix career. Can he leave Phillip Island as the MotoGP World Championship leader? Aleix Espargaró, 20 points behind Fabio Quartararo in the title chase. He was just 0.004 of a second off that front row at the end of qualifying yesterday. Aprilia tends to run pretty well around this Phillip Island circuit. Let's not forget, in our last visit here back in 2019, his then teammate Andrea Iannone went for broke and made the early running. Your front row of the grid then for this 2022 Grand Prix of Australia. Pecco Bagnaia, third place, as he tries to win Ducati's first Grand Prix here in 12 long years since Casey Stoner's success back in 2010.